Okay, my name is Doug Detterman. This is the 15th annual meeting, or the 16th annual meeting of ISIR. We're in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and David Lubinsky is about to interview Robert Plomin.
Well, Robert, it's great to have you here, and people are eager to hear about what the premier behavior geneticist in the world has to say about intelligence and where the field is going. Before we get into that, I would just like you to comment a bit about your educational history. Tell us about...
Okay, well, there's a long version, but I'll try and make it short, because I think it's relevant, really, to the society, in a way, mm-hmm. about intelligence testing. So I grew up in inner city Chicago, and my parents weren't university educated. I had 30 cousins, no one went to university. We had no books in our house. Because the school system, the Catholic school system was better, there was more discipline and that sort of thing, I went there. And I got a pretty good education there, I think. And I'd like to make a plug for the public libraries, because that's sort of what saved me. I had a red wagon, what do you call those, red flyers in America? Little red wagon. I went to the library about a half mile away, and I came back with a wagon full of books.
Really?
Yeah, so that was good. But the other thing that was good about the system is that they did a lot of testing. And as a result of testing, I was able to get a scholarship to go to DePaul with an L Academy, which was an all-boys academy. That was an academy to DePaul University. And you know, I could never have afforded to go there. So I got a scholarship to go there, and then I got a scholarship to go to DePaul University. I had no idea what the university was about. So what I was doing the whole time was working. I started working at about 10. Now, this is where the violin comes out here. But, but no, I started working delivering chickens from a poultry shop on my bicycle, you know. And then as I went to high school, I was working almost full time as a I started shoveling snow for this office of Association for Business Officials of the United States and Canada, and then I ended up, because the best thing I learned in high school was typing, so I saw that they were miserable at typing, so I just said, well, I could do that, I could do that. And so I ended up working full time, so I was just kind of working in school as I could, and then by the time I got to university, I just took courses that fit my work schedule, because by then I was running kind of national conferences for this place.
Really?
Yeah, so I was making huge amounts of money as a, you know, kid. And as a result, my education kind of suffered because I took courses that fit. So mm-hmm. I was in English for a while, film, and mostly in philosophy. And this is what I got to say about philosophy, because DePaul University specialized in phenomenology and eidetic reduction. Have you ever heard of that?
Right.
Duskness?
Yes.
After about the third time I heard that, I kept getting in trouble because I kept saying, well, if what this guy says is true, or this guy's, I kept trying to come up with empirical tests of it. And it dawned on me finally, the fourth time hearing about eidetic reduction, that if you can test it, it's no longer philosophy. So then I said, well, where do you test these things? They said psychology. So then I went into psychology.
That is interesting. Now, this sounds so scholarly and ambitious. But I heard a rumor you were actually kicked out of grade school.
Well, the downside of the Catholic schools, two downsides. One is those nuns were vicious. Uh-huh. I mean, man, yeah. Corporal punishment was no problem from their point of view.
Yeah.
But the other issue was I was about Catholic theology and dogma in those days. And I read this Time Life had this series of big green books on topics in biology. One of them was on evolution, so it was one of those books I got out of the library. I innocently read about Darwin's Galapagos trip and, you know, trip around the world, and I brought it in just saying, it's amazing, these finches, you know, different islands, evolution, and right out of class, because it was a mortal sin at that time to believe in evolution. But that was a good experience for me, because it made me think, well, they're so obviously wrong. I mean, this is so this has to be true. And if they're lying about this, you know, what else are they lying about? So
uh-huh.
It was on the road to atheism.
Uh-huh. Interesting. And then from DePaul, you went to Texas.
Well, that was another good story. You know, Marilyn Brewer, who was Biggie, her ex-husband was Bob Brewer, and he was at DePaul University. And I had no idea about graduate school in my family. If you could go to university, then you can go to law school where you make a lot of money, mm-hmm. and all the crooked politicians in Chicago went to DePaul University. So that's what I was supposed to do. But I realized that it was exactly not my skill set, you know, memorizing stuff and arguing without concern for truth, mm-hmm. you know? So it sounds pompous, but it really was an important recognition for me, and I really started liking psychology. But I was making lots of money, and I had no idea what graduate school was. Bob Brewer got applications for me, said, why don't you apply to these places? And then Arnie Buss, you know, uh-huh. David Buss is his son, he sometimes right. comes here. And Arnie Buss called me like in January, totally illegally, and he said, we'll give you a scholarship if you come to Texas, but you have to let me know right away. You know, it's totally illegal, you're not supposed to do that. But I said, well, right, you know, magic words, they'll pay me to come. Not only give me a scholarship, but, you know, pay me a stipend and everything. So I said, right. sounds good to me. So that's how I went to Texas. I had no idea there was a behavioral genetics program there. I went into their personality program, which was basically general psychology. Because uh-huh. I liked individual differences. And then in the second year, I said, the other question, answers aren't going to be this long-winded, but
okay.
I'm on a roll here. Okay, so one of the core courses that we had to take in the second year was behavioral genetics. It was the only place in the world where they had behavioral genetics because John Lowland was there
sure.
at the time, and he team taught a course with Gardner Lindsay, you know, past president of APA,
sure.
who became convinced genetics was going to be important. And the neat thing was, David and I, we were talking about caprice and, you know, how much chance plays a role in all of
right.
this. But what I don't understand is I was completely floored by that course. You know, it just seemed to me it had all the things I liked. You know, it was kind of controversial, yet the data looked very strong,
mm-hmm.
talking about big effects. So these weren't teensy, you know,
right.
statistically significant findings. They're big findings.
You can see them.
So it floored me.
Yeah.
Mostly animal research, which is even more impressive. You know, you get these, breed these lines for behavior.
Yeah.
So I was completely bowled over. But 39 other students in that class, not one of them, became interested in behavioral genetics. So. You know, I don't know what that's about. I really honestly don't have a clue. But from then on, you know, I was set. I just found something I loved to do. And
mm-hmm.
and then I was lucky after that. You know, I got this first job at Boulder at the Institute for Behavioral Genetics.
Right.
So
Before we go to Boulder, just because you're so passionate about individual differences and understanding people, How did the animal research in your background get in there?
Well, that was after taking the behavioral genetics course, I decided animal behavioral genetics is very powerful because you can manipulate the environment, you can manipulate genes, but you can't do either of those very well for humans. So I thought animal research is great, and I wanted to combine it with evolution, so I trapped these mice in the highest places you can in Colorado, and in the driest places you can, in Mexico, for example, trying to look for individual differences to really test genetic drift.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mice on one side of the barn are genetically different from mice on the other side versus evolutionary, you know, selection pressure.
Right.
So I was really keen on it, and I did a lot of work on it for a year. And then it's another example of chance, which I understand applies to you as well,
yes.
allergies.
Yeah.
In those days, there was no health and safety.
Right.
And I was in this little closet, no airflow or anything, with breeding these mice and all of that, and so I got a terrific allergy. So that even now, if this paper had been in a mouse lab, you know, my eyes will get red, and yeah, it's really bad. And I think that you were working with pigeons,
right.
and the same thing happened?
Yes, same thing happened. Yeah. I wasn't attracted to pigeons. It was just this one experiment that I wanted to do, but... And then Boulder came along.
Another example of chance, though. You know, I think it's important for people to know there's a fair amount of chance here, and you just kind of have to maximize probabilities,
right.
not just go for one thing. You know, you have to have options open there. But I wanted to stay on at Texas after my fourth year where I got my PhD. And, you know, I was kind of excited about it. I had a lot of research going on. But then at Boulder, the Institute for Behavioral Genetics, the only place in the world where there's an institute devoted to that back then, This was 74.
Yeah.
They had hired a guy, and he died, committed suicide, actually, in June. So John Lolan got a call from the people at IBG and said, do you have anyone that would be good for this? And so John recommended me. And it was a joint appointment in psychology and the Institute for Behavioral Genetics. You know, it was a dream job. And then Boulder, of course, was a dream place
right.
at those times. You know, there was a Newsweek cover story then, where the hip come to trip. Boulder, Colorado.
1974.
Yep. So, and also, the show you how things have changed. I mean, I basically had the job on the basis of John Lolan's recommendation. I had to go there and give a little talk, but it was pro forma.
Interesting. Well, if John likes you, I don't know how much things have changed. He has a lot of pull in this area. You know, you went from, people will be interested because you went from Colorado to Penn State, and now you're at London. And those transitions, you know, people who are as successful as you have been, they go where the opportunities are. And could you talk a little bit about what motivated the moves? And
yeah, I wish it were like that. I wish my life were more rational and,
yeah.
you know, I made these choices. In this case, it's chercher la femme, in a way. I was at Colorado, very happy there. And then I met my wife, Judy Dunn, and I thought Colorado, she's a fairly well-known social developmental psychologist,
right.
and they should be happy to have her. And you know, it wasn't going well. I mean, and in contrast, Jerry McLaren, who had founded the Institute for Behavioral Genetics, had gone to Penn State. And when he heard about this, he had the dean of the college from Penn State fly out, talk to us, and very cleverly recruited her, and
uh-huh.
and then knew that I would come along.
Uh-huh.
So that's how that happened.
Interesting.
And then she didn't like Penn State, and so we spent our summers and a lot of time in London, Cambridge actually,
mm-hmm.
the real Cambridge. And when Professor Sir Michael Rutter saw this, he wondered if we would consider coming back. And Judy Dunn had her family there, so she was very keen to come back. And this is an example of what's different about the UK and the US. Because the UK is small scale and everybody knows each other, they set up these research professorships for us. We could take them where we wanted, but we wanted to go to the Institute for what's now Psychiatry, Psychology, and Neuroscience. It was the Institute for Psychiatry then. The contract says you cannot teach, you cannot do administration, all you can do is research.
Really?
So that sounded pretty good. And they gave us a lot of money to set up this new center, research
right.
center. It has this funny name, Social Developmental Genetic Psychiatry, SGDP. But the gist of it is to bring genetic and environmental strategies together to study behavioral development. So that was, you know, great to do. I was always in interdisciplinary centers, and I was very happy to set one up from scratch.
Mm-hmm. What an opportunity. Yeah. You know, people think of your research now as looking for these genes, many genes that have small effects that contribute to intelligence. Where you're at now was a long journey for you. And could you say a little bit about how you get to where you're at and what your take is now on the important hypotheses to be examining?
Okay. Well, before I forget, I am talking tomorrow on my latest project on trying to find genes, you know, that account for the heritability of intelligence.
Okay.
So some of this will come out then, but the stuff.
But it won't be on tape, so.
Okay. And also, I won't be talking about the background that you're talking about. So it was 20 years ago I started to try and find genes for intelligence. I felt at that time we didn't need any more heritability studies showing
right.
that it's heritable, because it's one of the most. You know,
yeah.
it's hardly a study that disagrees with that finding of substantial heritability. So the next step seemed to be to try to find genes. So the DNA revolution was happening about then. We did candidate gene studies, and I did the first genome-wide association study before any of these DNA chips were available, the hard way, you know, genotyping people.
Right.
But we used a strategy called DNA pooling. And it became more and more clear to me that the strategies that were in effect at the time, like linkage, they could only detect very big effects. candidate gene studies, people just assumed, you know, it's dopamine and, you know, it's things that people tend to study in terms of pathways that would be reasonable with cognitive processes. But I came to see that the effects that were being reported weren't replicating, and that when we do genome-wide studies, we're having trouble detecting effects. You know, it's changing now. You'll hear some of that tomorrow from James Lee, and I'll talk a bit about that tomorrow. We're beginning to find the effects, but they're very, very small. So linkage, I think, in reasonable size samples, where you need family pedigrees, can detect effects that account for about 10% of the variance. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking for a single gene that accounts for 100% of the variance, that's tremendous power. You know?
Right.
So it's great. But linkage wasn't coming up with anything, not just for intelligence, but for anything in psychiatry, any complex traits or common disorders, nothing. So association studies, people were using sample sizes, candidate gene studies, that would detect effects that maybe are 2% of the variance, something like that. Which then people said, God, that's so small. Why would you even want to find a gene that accounted for 2% of the variance? Mm-hmm. But now, with these big genome-wide association studies, nobody's finding effects that account for more than 0.5% of variance. And really, in intelligence, we're talking about maybe 0.2, 0.1% of the variance, mm-hmm. the biggest effects. What people haven't quite understood is, when you're trying to find effects that small, you need huge samples, tremendous power. However, you can disprove, you can say, there's enough lots of power here to exclude the possibility of large effects. Mm-hmm. So you can exclude the possibility that there are any effects bigger than 2% that account for 2% of the variance. So it is a real revolution, but there's some promising things too that I'll talk about tomorrow, but basically polygenic scores. Nobody's looking for the one or two genes for intelligence. They're not even looking for the handful of genes. We're talking thousands, tens of thousands of genes, each a very small effect. Perhaps different effects for you and for me, mm-hmm. so that in the population they end up looking like even smaller effects.
Right.
But you can put a whole bunch of them together like items on a test. And you know, if you tried to say, is this item you're reliable or everything, it's really hard to prove that.
Right.
But you just say, okay, there's some error here, but let's hope we capture true variance.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we're at with these polygenic scores, and that's really where I think we're going to get traction for translation.
Great. And how are you handling the power issue with extreme phenotypes?
Well, that is exactly my talk tomorrow. It's everyone else is trying to, you know, the thing you do if you want to detect smaller and smaller effects, bigger and bigger samples.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll hear tomorrow, I think James Lee's talking about 350,000 subjects for educational attainment. But in IQ, there, you know, we published a study on 20,000. Then last year, earlier this year, there was 55,000. And there's one that's going to be from Biobank in the UK, which will be 500,000 people eventually, but it's only on the first 100,000 people. And it's now together accounting for about 5% of the variance. But again, the biggest effect is about 0.2% of the variance. But you know, 5% seems pitifully small, but this stuff has only been going on about 5 years. And there's, as I'll talk about tomorrow, there's a lot of new technological developments that are promising, at least. So I think we'll get there, and even with 5% of the variance,
right.
you can use it for research. You can select extreme groups genotypically, uh-huh. for example. So, you know, it's been, as you say, a very long haul. I was never thinking I'd spend 20 years trying to find genes. I would be happy if God came down sometime and said, you know, these are the ones. Because what I wanted to do is to use them to study things like development and GE correlation and interaction. And yet we still are not really quite there, but I think we'll be there in the next few years, accounting for maybe 10% of the variance.
Okay. And you're going to leverage profoundly gifted populations?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't say it. Yeah, thanks for reminding me that. Everyone is increasing sample sizes to try and detect smaller effects.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't like to do what everyone else is doing.
Right.
It's kind of an ornery part of my nature, I think.
Yeah.
And I thought a different strategy that takes advantage of what's unique about intelligence is to say, unlike schizophrenia or all the other diseases that people are studying, it's normally distributed. There's a positive end as well as a negative end. And we could use that to our advantage because of the quantitative genetic model that says from Fisher in 1918, there's many, many genes of small effect. He was, you know, right.
Right.
I don't think anyone realized how small the effects are.
Right.
But if you take people at the super high end, it seems to me reasonable to think they're going to have most of the positive effects and very few of the negative effects.
Mm-hmm.
And you think, well, why not do that at the super low end? But it turns out there's very good reasons not to. There's etiological differences
right.
at the low end, like de novo mutations and mm-hmm. things like that. So that was the idea. Instead of just increasing, you know, the brute force approach of larger samples, I thought it would be kind of cool to say, let's get super bright people. And so we're talking about people with IQs over 170, thanks to you.
Mm-hmm.
As I'll say tomorrow, you were the person who made this possible through the studies for mathematically precocious children. And so we were able to get, I don't know how much we want to go into this, but we were able to get of the 900,000 people
yeah.
in the Southeast at the Duke TIP,
yeah.
Talent Identification Project, take the top 1% of those and then the top of those
mm-hmm.
so that by extrapolation you were able to estimate that their IQs are about above 170.
Yes, yep.
So that's the idea.
So the genie's in the bottle.
The genie's in the bottle?
Mm-hmm.
Well, just so no one gets overly excited here about my talk tomorrow, I mean, basically, it didn't work very well.
Yeah. we've got the phenotype, but not the genotype.
Yeah, but you figure if you got 2,000 people, say, mm-hmm. who have IQs of 170, what would that be if you just had a large population?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it'd be millions, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
So it's a reasonable strategy, I think. And I did want to emphasize, we're not looking for genes for genius. We're looking at this as a strategy for finding genes responsible for the heritability of intelligence throughout the distribution.
Right, right. Okay. You know, in the midst of all this, all the research you've been doing and things, you've also found time to write a textbook on behavior genetics. That has gone through, what, 5 editions now?
Well, no, 6, and the 7th we're submitting this month.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
okay. And how did that start? Why do you invest time in that?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. It's partly, I don't know how you feel about it, but there's a lot of criticism along the way, right? And some people, Tom Bouchard is very good, for example, about putting in the time, trying to respond to people who are criticizing this stuff. I decided long ago that generally the people who were criticizing behavioral genetics didn't have anything better to do.
Uh-huh.
And as soon as you said, well, no, you take that seriously, you show here the data, they come up with 10 other objections. You
right.
know, you could spend your life doing it. So I decided long ago I wasn't going to do that.
Yeah.
I was going to take a long view on it, something like, you know, old dogs and new tricks, something like that, and look to students and say, you know, what I would like is, and I think it's happening already, it's happened here. I mean, where basically students will say, what's the big deal? I mean, of course genetics is important,
right.
and so is environment.
Right.
And so writing the textbook was a way of doing that. It was sort of compensating for not dealing with all the criticism, you know, that came along on a one-by-one basis. Because I haven't found that you're very often going to convince people
right.
who are just dead set against the notion of genetics for mm-hmm. political reasons as well as anything else. So
mm-hmm.
Whether that's right or wrong, I decided to look towards students and to write this textbook. So there was an edition with DeFries and McLaren, and it was a how to be a behavioral genetics book. And so what I wanted to do is to convert it to like art appreciation, behavioral genetics appreciation. This is what we know, more than this is how we know it, or this is how you can become a behavioral geneticist. So it's been, I think, quite successful, and it's the only major book in the market, and so I'm pleased they did. It's a lot of work, but
yeah.
it keeps you on top of the field,
mm-hmm.
and so it's fun in some ways, and I have very good co-authors as well.
You also, and this is very interesting, because one of the most profound discoveries psychology has is the documentation of individual differences in learning rates among students. It's absolutely profound, and it underscores why one size won't fit all for all students. And you have now gone on to write a book about behavioral genetics for educators?
For intelligence research, I think it's learning ability, basically, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And education is sort of the business end of that.
Yeah.
And yet, there's very little work done on genetics, intelligence, and education. And so my limited goal at first was just to get people in, to be able to put those three words together in one sentence without people getting very upset. And I've seen signs of change there. But I've got to say, apologies to people who are in education here, but it's the backwater of science, you know? And it's, you know, you spend as much money, most developed countries, on education as you do on health.
Yeah.
Health is so evidence-based. You can't do anything with that. Education doesn't know what evidence is.
Yeah.
I stopped talking about genetics because until people accept evidence and individual differences, you know, save your breath. You don't talk mm-hmm. about genetics.
Right.
So I think it's like shooting fish in a barrel, and I think eventually, you know, the time is right for us to start talking about these things they're interested in, not just intelligence, educational achievement, behavior problems. These are some of the most heritable things around, yet you look at teacher education books, they don't mention it.
Right.
Yet we did a survey of teachers, and they recognize that kids differ in their ability to learn. But what still happens, you also see this with obesity, I think, which is another good example. You know, when kids aren't doing well at school, the first knee-jerk reaction, you blame the schools, you blame the teachers, blame the parents, and if you run out of people to blame, you can blame the kids themselves, you know, they're just not sufficiently motivated or something like that. But if you recognize that genetics accounts for a huge amount of variance, at least 50%, educational achievement may be more than intelligence, maybe
right.
60%.
Right.
And then you say, okay, all our concern about schools, how much of the variance of educational achievement differences among children is accounted for schools, if you just talk about that as a group variable? It's less than 20%, and that's before you take into account SES and stuff like that. So it's not the pit nature versus nurture, but it's to say 60% is a lot of variance in yeah. the behavioral sciences to explain. And then to totally ignore it just seems to me, you know, it's like Alice in Wonderland stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very excited about taking research on genetics and intelligence to schools, educational achievement. And I think it's important that we do that now because I do believe in the next few years, DNA chips, these arrays that you can use that genotype millions of single nucleotide polymorphisms, that's going to be a game changer
mm-hmm.
because we're not talking about family risk. We'd be talking about predicting from birth, prenatally,
right.
individual differences in learning ability.
Right. I'm glad, I'm so glad you wrote that book. It was hard for me to put down. I read it in a couple days. And the way you framed arguments and explained things to people, I just highly recommend that book.
Thank you. I do have to say, though, that sort of good writing is the co-author, the first author, Catherine okay. Asbury, who's one of my PhD students, and I'm very pleased to say, got the first job as a behavioral geneticist in a Department of Education.
Very
at
nice.
York University in England, and she was an English major at Cambridge, so she writes extremely well, so all the good writing was hers.
Just like Lolan, an English major.
That's right, exactly,
yeah.
And I always admired Lolan's writing.
Absolutely.
Really, people should look at it, because it's sort of my model for, what did Voltaire say, to be clear is to be brief. I mean, and there's no bullshit in the writing, you
yes.
know, it's just right on.
Yeah. Good.
Is John here? Am I embarrassing
John
you?
John is here.
Uh-oh.
And we can embarrass him.
Okay.
It's okay. Where do you see the field going in the next 20 years?
Well, I'm kind of have a one-track mind here. And, you know, for me, there's nothing that's going to change the field more than finding these genes.
Uh-huh.
So for me, that's far and away the most important thing. And then once you find genes, then I want to use them kind of a phenotypic level to study things like development, as I said, and GE correlation and interaction. But then you can begin to look at all the levels of explanation between genes, brain, and behavior. And Roberto was talking this morning about brain, but I think there are many levels of analysis.
Right.
And in some ways, you know, going from the, as they call it, the genome to the transcriptome of gene expression, you know, all the way up to the proteome and metabolome and getting up to the brain, you know, it's going to be lifetimes of research to try and work out those pathways. I myself am more interested in the behavioral level itself
mm-hmm.
and using these genes to predict
Yeah. At this point in time, what do you consider your most important scientific contribution?
Well, I think, I don't know if it's most important, but what I'm proudest of, I think, is, scientifically, is using genetics to study the environment.
Right.
Because I think that was quite a shocker for people. Mm-hmm. The idea of non-shared environment, which we heard today, you know, people tend to just accept that now. There's some shared environment for intelligence, but it declines by adolescence, say, to mm-hmm. about zero, whereas most of our environmental theories are family-based and
right.
kind of between family-based, as Joe Rogers was talking about this morning.
Right.
So I think the idea that environment's important, you know, heritability isn't 100%, and we need to find out what those environmental factors are, but it's important to know they're not the ones we thought were important. And so it's kind of a whole new era. Why are children in the same family so different? One of the books I wrote.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But the other aspect of it that interests me even more is you hear a lot about GE interaction, different strokes for different folks, you mm-hmm. know? And that's an important area, but I don't think it's nearly as important in a larger sense as genotype environment correlation. And because I think that's the way genotypes become phenotypes. That's the way genetics affects intelligence. You know, so one of the most highly heritable cognitive tests is vocabulary.
Right.
You know, and so people, how can vocabulary be inherited? Because they have the wrong view, you know, that somehow inherited means DNA codes for vocabulary
right.
words, you know. But it's obvious that what it is some kids pick, they tune in to the verbal channel.
Right.
I have one grandchild, I have six grandchildren, one of them, mm-hmm. wants to know about nuances of words. And the other kid would say, whatever. You
yeah,
know?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's, I think, the way genes work, is they're correlated with our, they create propensities and nudges to move us in certain directions.
Uh-huh.
And I'm really interested in how genes, genotypes use environments. They select and modify and create environments correlated with their genetic propensities. And you see that in super bright kids, you know, like that.
Oh, yeah.
A Charlesworth study was really nice of Mensa kids and just how are they different from other kids. It's like the questions they ask. They walk into a room and there's every room has a corner, right?
Yeah.
Whoever notices a corner. These kids will ask about, did you ever notice that the angles involved in the corner? You know, they just notice. They get more out of their environment.
They do.
Think. And what interests me about that is our view of the environment is very passive. You know, it comes from stimulus response.
Right.
You know, we're the organism, the stimulus affects us. You know, it's stuff out there that happens to us.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what's important about the environment is this idea of GE correlation. It's the way we use our environments. And we don't have good ways of measuring that, even.
Right.
But I think this idea of active construction of environments is an important way to go. And it's a whole new model. You think of it in education. Its instruction comes from the Latin, which means to shove it in. That's
mm-hmm.
the way we think about education. You have a curriculum and you shove it in these kids' heads. But what's important is education, which means to draw out. It's to give kids opportunities to see what they like to do
yeah.
as well as what they're good at. And I think these appetites are as important for intelligence as the aptitudes.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a favorite contribution that you've made to intelligence, per se?
Well, I like the finding of heritability increasing throughout the lifespan. And that wasn't just my finding. Sandra Scar, well, her data first pointed it out, you know, where she had
right.
these adopted kids who correlated with their adoptive parents for IQ of about 0.3. And by the time they were in adolescence, they correlated zero. Well, it was one study, 87 families or something like that. But then John Lowland had this Texas adoption project, which was a much larger project, and they were studied longitudinally. The correlation between IQ of those adopted children and their adoptive parents at 8, when the kids
right.
were 8, was 0.25. At 16, it was zero. And that's very powerful evidence that the shared environmental influences decline. And similarly, on the genetic side, all the data, twin studies, adoption studies, are consistent with a linear increase in heritability from 20% in infancy, 40% in adolescence, 60% in adulthood, and some people say even 80% in later life if you exclude dementia. And, you know, it's one of the things I love about behavioral genetics is these results replicate.
Right.
And that isn't an obvious finding. I mean, people wouldn't have predicted that heritability increases. In fact, most people, if they understand it, they'd say, no, heritability decreases for two wrong reasons. One is they think of genetics as what happens at the moment of conception. Mm-hmm. And then they think if it's heritable, it's immutable, and all of that. So it's a neat finding in a lot of ways, I think, that the heritability of intelligence increases linearly throughout the lifespan. And it's a big difference, 20% to 60%. And shared environmental influences decrease from childhood to adolescence. So in the long run, family differences don't matter in terms of individual differences in IQ. Environment matters, but it's not those shared environmental factors.
Right, right. You know, Robert, you do so many things and you're so productive. I think people would really be interested in how you structure your professional life and your time. How consistent are you? How sporadic are you?
Yeah.
When do you write?
Oh, God, this is really boring. I mean,
it's not boring to me.
Well, it's embarrassing is the correct word.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because I'm incredibly structured. I mean, I confess, I get up at 3 in the morning.
Okay.
And I work till 7.
All right.
And that came about when I had young kids and I had a wife who was paralyzed, and bring out the violins again, but it went on for several years, and I'd always been an early riser. In my family, we never slept past 7, maybe 8 o'clock in the morning ever. I mean, it was kind of sinful to do that. And, you know, there are individual differences, and I was always a morning person. You know, I just do better in the morning. So that was so reinforcing. I started working in the mornings, you know, 4:30 for several years. But then when I had to take care of the kids during the day, because my wife was paralyzed, it was the only time I had quiet time to concentrate and work. And I must say for people, loving your work, it can be the rock of your life. You know,
right.
It can be the steadying force when everything else is falling apart,
right.
You know, if you can compartmentalize it enough. So I just work so much better in the morning. Like if I'm at night and I'm trying to figure something out, it's hard. In the morning, I just went, what was the problem? I mean, this is simple. It's just that my mind just works so much better in the morning. And so it's so rewarding, partly because I have one rule about it, and that is I don't ever do what I have to do from 3 to 7. This is like reading, writing, you know, thinking about things. Even no matter how pressing the grant reports are, or
right.
student dissertations or whatever, just don't do it. Because once you let it in,
yep.
it eats everything up. You know, so it's like sacred time for me. This is where I do nothing, maybe. I mean, you know, you just sit and stare at a piece of paper, you read a few articles, nothing happens. But that's where I do all my writing. I only write in the morning. I don't try to work when I go to work. I mean, I don't try to write when I go to work.
Right.
And yeah, it's worked out really well for me. But I would say that I'm not advocating this for everybody. You know, it's just individual differences.
Right.
But it has really been an important part of my life that, fortunately, I just sleep very well. I mean, partly because I'm sleep deprived. You know, I get 4 or 5 hours of sleep a night. But then I have to take these little power naps of 5 minutes, 10 minutes. But I can go to sleep, you know, anywhere, almost instantly. I don't know if I could do it here, but I could get close, probably.
So you do a couple of those during the day, or?
You know, it's really embarrassing, but I'll be honest. That's so rigid. You know, I work from 3 to 5, and then I do exercises from 5 to 5:30, and then I take a nap for 10 minutes, and then I work on through to 7, and then I take a nap at 10. And you wonder how you can do that in your office, but you know, I've gotten to the point where I'm sure other people here can do it too. But you know, if I have a meeting in 5 minutes, I say, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to last for that. You know, I get psychotically tired at that point. I can nap and without an alarm, wake up in 3 minutes.
And you set an alarm?
No, I do not set an alarm. And I say, wait, this has got to be a short nap, 3 minutes, wake up, and I'm good for three hours after that.
I don't know how many people could do that. Well, I think they have to set an alarm.
It's training, and that's why I don't like to travel, because travel totally screws it up. You know, it takes a while. It's like being in training, really.
Yeah.
You know? Getting by on as little sleep as you can without being completely crazy.
Wow. Okay. So you sleep about, your solid interval is about 5 hours.
That's what I do best on. I can get by on 4, but 5 I do best on. I can do that forever.
That is incredible. Yeah. You experience more life that way. Yeah. What are you proudest of?
So sort of not scientific finding, say more professionally. I think it sounds like bragging, but I feel I've done a lot to bring genetics to psychology. And you know, Sandra Scar, whom you know from Minnesota days, and she was always saying, I'm such a wuss, you know, you gotta get out a 2x4 and hit him over the head with it, you know, about genetics. Whereas I felt that that was counterproductive, even some of Sandra's stuff, you know, like that SRCD presidential address. I think, you know, people react against it. So I think you gotta decide if you wanna get your yayas out and just cathart, or if you really want to advance the field and get people to accept it. So I got involved in things like the MacArthur Network. So we got people like Kagan, who was very anti-genetic.
Yes.
And Mavis Hetherington, very anti-genetic. And we did a large study. So instead of trying to convince them and talking to them, we said, let's just do a study. Let's incorporate your measures in this large twin study. And that just, you know, because they're sort of scientists. They're not going to argue with data. And they see these data, and they're, you know, just amazed by the power of genetics.
Uh-huh.
So I found that a useful strategy, and bringing some top people along helped a lot, I think, in making it more acceptable. Because now, you know, there's no flack in talking about genetics and psychology.
But pretty
man,
much.
When I started in the 70s,
yes.
My first conference, can I go off on this?
It's, yes.
It was the Eastern APA, Eastern Psychological Association. So here I am, second year graduate student, I'm going to this meeting, I'm just gotten excited about genetics. And that's where Leon Kamen, so this was 72, was giving his first talks on his book that became the 1974 book, Intelligence, Politics, and IQ, or something like that,
uh-huh.
Which just said anybody doing work in this area is politically motivated and it's not the right, you know, politically correct thing to do and the data are all junk. And it really, it was scary, because it was, you know, if you've seen Kamen, he's kind of balding, and he was on this podium, and there was dark room, and there were 3,000 people in the room, and it was like a rabble-rousing witch hunt or something, you know, basically saying, let's get these people who are bringing genetics into, you know, psychology. So it was a very scary thing. I said, we're behavioral geneticists, not me, not here, you know, I wasn't sticking my neck out there.
Uh-huh.
It was really an eye-opener to me to see someone as bright as Kamen just being so unscientific about it,
yeah.
You know. But he actually helped the field, as a lot of critics did, because, you know, if everyone accepted genetics as being important, we wouldn't have had those 10 decades there where we got lots of money to do bigger and better studies.
Yeah. You know, in terms of, I don't want to embarrass you, but in terms of what you're proudest of, I can sort of turn that around, because I have talked to a number of your former graduate students and postdocs, and your mentoring is absolutely spectacular. And what they're proudest of is having you as an advisor.
Well, thank you.
You just need to know that.
Well, I do. And one of the professional things that I didn't mention is that I'm very proud about how well these students have done. You know, I think we've placed more students in academic posts than just about anyone. And I really believe in mentoring after the PhD.
Absolutely.
I mean, I tell my students, PhD is a bureaucratic exercise.
Yeah.
Papers are important.
Yep.
Working on your career, fellowships, getting good postdocs, getting into posts. It goes on, you know, till tenure at least,
yeah.
I think, where, you know, you really support them in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, I think, what I've done as much as it is selection. I don't know how you feel about it, but I think it's at least 80% selection. You know, we got these really bright people. The important thing is to give them the opportunities to do their stuff, which might be to find out they don't really like doing this. That's fine,
right.
too.
Right.
But to you know, kind of stay out of their way and just support them.
Yeah.
You know.
And well, Paul Sackett is here. He'll talk about the variance in selection.
Oh right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
and I think you're right, but. But you provide the right environment.
Well, and it's fun, too. I mean,
yeah.
I can't understand people don't want to work with graduate students. I don't actually like postdocs, because postdocs, you know, it's kind of like a holding pattern, isn't it, by and large, and they know what they want to do, and it's eye open for another job. I mean, I know the postdocs here aren't like that particularly, but PhD students are kind of, you know, they can be formed and
uh-huh.
you know, open-minded about what they want to do. They can go with new stuff, and
yeah.
and you know, a lot of the good stuff I've done has been stimulated by them.
Sure.
Know? So I find it very exciting to work with these really bright students. It's another advantage in the UK that we get students from all over Europe, the very best students from all over Europe. So I have a student, or students from a couple from Germany and Poland, and we had one from China. Well, they're all over. I think we have, I have currently one English student. All the rest are from other countries. And that's kind of enriching, too.
Sure.
You know?
Absolutely. You know, you've had so many experiences in the academy and opportunities. I'm just curious, do you have any professional regrets that are particularly poignant for you? Or?
Well, I'm not very introspective, I have to admit, so this sort of interview doesn't work very well with me, and I don't really have regrets. And that's not just smugness. I mean, I think I've led a charmed life. I've been, you know, quantitative genetics was just coming in, and then molecular genetics was like a second stage of a rocket, you know, making things take off again. So I feel I've just been incredibly lucky, and with the people I've worked at with and the places I've worked at. So, I mean, my only professional regret is that it's 20 years and we still don't have genes for IQ.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's a big regret. But
sure.
I'm not leaving till
you're not gonna give up.
We do.
Okay. Over the course of your personal development, who were your intellectual heroes?
Well, sorry to disappoint you again, because I know you believe in heroes, but I actually don't believe in heroes. Part of what I do is to depersonalize science. And I know there's reasons not to do that. But have you ever noticed when I write, or my students write, I think people are in parentheses.
Yeah.
So I don't say, you know, Lubinsky and Benbow showed this.
Yeah.
I would say, this has been shown, or we know this, and then put you in brackets.
Mm-hmm.
I think it reads better because the names, you know, disrupt the flow.
Right, right.
But I think it's right that, you know, science isn't people. I mean, it's about facts. And what I like about behavioral genetics is it's a very cumulative science, and we're all working on a field, and you know the data, it's progressive. This guy, Peter Urbeck, wrote a very great paper in 1978, Behavioral Genetics as a Progressive Science. It builds on itself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as I see a lot of psychology as faddish, you know, this is the current fad, and then by the time people do dissertations on it, it's no longer the fad, and then, you know, it's off somewhere else. Not because they've solved the problems.
Right. Just
people got bored with it or something.
Right.
And then we come back and visit it again 20, 30 years later.
Mm-hmm.
So I do, so there's certainly lots of people I admire, but I prefer to think of, it's the science I think that's important, and I don't really like having heroes, I guess.
Uh-huh.
That sounds very
harsh. Well, no, that's fair enough. No, that's good, yeah. I want you to think about this because of the way your former graduate students and postdocs have responded to you and what they say about you now. Lot of young academics in the crowd who would like to know what you would advise them. Who are starting out in the field of intelligence?
Well, there's a lot of platitudes, I suppose, you know, about finding things you'd like to do and that sort of thing. But there's one thing that's kind of personal to me and won't work for everybody. But for me, what's been exciting is interdisciplinary approaches, combining fields like genetics and intelligence. I think a lot of the biggest findings come out when you look across fields in an interdisciplinary way. You know, it's important that people are down there in the furrows as well, you know, with specialty knowledge. But I do think there's a lot of pressure to specialize, and I think it's important for some people to think about taking a more interdisciplinary approach. But it takes a certain sort of person. You know, I've always worked in interdisciplinary environments.
Right.
And I'd like to do a heritability study of how susceptible people are to interdisciplinary approaches. Because what it means, like when you combine molecular and quantitative genetics and intelligence, you know, individual differences, all the model fitting and everything that goes with this, it takes a person who's able to relinquish control enough to trust their colleagues who are expert on things, to realize you're not going to be an expert on all of these things.
Right.
You have to trust other people. And And some people just don't seem very suited to that. And science isn't, you know, like in biology, you know, it's getting, knowing more and more about less and less. You know, it's this super specialization, knowing more about one tiny thing than anybody else in the world. I'm not knocking it, you know, that's how science proceeds too. But I would just say to give a thought to interdisciplinarity. And the other thing I'd say is even more pompous, I'm afraid, but several times people have mentioned the current crisis of replication in science. And I have a paper coming out, I think I sent you on in the APS Perspectives on Psychological Science, about behavioral genetics results replicating.
Right.
And there's a long, you know, people, if they're not aware of this crisis, they should be, because it's a really real crisis. And what I loved about behavioral genetics, as I said before, these results replicate. They're big findings, and yet they consistently replicate. And so I examine reasons why they replicate and that sort of thing. But what I wanted to say about it, and intelligence, I think, could write a paper like that too.
Yeah.
I mean, people still say, oh, gee, what is this? You know, when I do these interviews, you know, it just drives me mad. You know, I say, oh, call David Lubinsky and talk about this. Uh-huh. You know, how can you measure it? You know, it's just what intelligence tests measure. You know, and you say, show me some other finding in psychology that's as well documented as G.
I know.
You know, so I think you could do that from an intelligence point of view, too. But the point I wanted to make is that it's scary advice, but the advice I'd like to give to younger people is that they think about making big findings, but true findings. Mm-hmm. Not to get sucked up into something where, you know, you present the best side of these data and you squeak a paper through. I mean, mm-hmm. you could say easy for me to say I have hundreds of papers, but it is important initially that we are think of ourselves as truth seekers, because once you fall off of that, you know, it's a slippery slope. And then for me, I don't believe in religion, but I think the religious aspect of science, that's heresy, you know, to just, you know, you don't even do it consciously, but, you know, people start pushing the data and telling a story that isn't really there.
Right.
So I do think it's important early in people's career to commit to honesty and truth, being a truth seeker, rather than just doing what you have to do to publish. I don't know if you've noticed, but I think, actually, Ian Edes has shown this, hasn't he, that the failure to replicate is greater in the top journals. And if you ever notice when you get a paper in your area in Science or Nature, you say, that's crap. That would never have gotten published in a specialty journal. Mm-hmm. And the reason is it has legs. It goes out to these reviewers who don't really know about it.
Right.
And to get it in, you can't have any flaw. Everything has to be perfect.
Right.
Well, when have you done a study, you know, where everything is exactly perfect, you know? But in science, or nature, you just say, well, it really came out this way, there's this one little bit, dead, you know? So, and science isn't like that, really. Mm-hmm. So I do think it's so important that we commit to seeking truth rather than publication.
That's a very interesting point. Yeah. Well, you know, we're doing very well here. This is fascinating. I think at this point, what I'd like to do, though, is open it up
That'd
to
be
the
great.
Audience.
Good.
Because I know a lot of people have questions for you.
I want to publicly acknowledge your contribution to intelligence. And people will find it's hard to believe, but you've been one of the most faithful and insightful reviewers I've had. I went up and looked up the number of articles you've reviewed since we went online, and it's 92 over a period of 9 years.
Well, thank
and the
you,
question I have for you is why? Given everything else you do, why?
And why
can you
I do
give
the reviewing?
Any advice to younger people?
Well, it's a good question, Doug. You know, so the question is basically, why do I do a lot of reviewing?
Yeah. Why are you so faithful? By the way, your response time is 9 days. There are a lot of people in this room who are very ashamed right now.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't review everything I'm asked to do. I've decided I can only review things that have a genetic slant on it because, you know, that's my real expertise, right? So the things you send me are things that I know something about. But it's a really good point. You know, I have friends who just never review papers. They say, what's in it for me to review a paper? And yet they submit lots of papers that lots of us have to review, so it isn't fair. It's not good citizenship is one thing. But the other thing is, I find it's the only time I really read a paper and think about it, you know? And so it's rewarding to me to do it. I mean, I love it when it's more and more now, if I see it's a loser, I don't review it. You know, my mother always said, you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all. So I do tend to do that more and more now. But it's really nice when you get a paper that's good and you want to help make it better. I mean, that's the ideal. So I think it's good, it's good fun, and especially with you as editor, and you know, you're great with the getting people to take things, respond to them seriously, and
you have been an extremely constructive reviewer.
Well, thank you very much. Thanks.
When you say 1,000 genes may be related to intelligence, maybe 10,000, do you mean that in any individual person who's very bright, they have all 1,000 genes?
No. I think they have most of the positive alleles. So I think the problem is going to be that there are different genes that are affecting our intelligence, that when you look at a population level, the effect sizes are incredibly small. But if you encompass a lot of those, knowing they don't work for you, but they work for Roberto, some of them, you know, in the population then, you should be able to make predictions. So so that's, I guess, basically the way I look at it.
This is tied to brain imaging work that asks questions like Roberto was talking about this morning. What brain circuits are related to intelligence? Well, for some people it'll be these circuits, for other people it'll be those circuits. Mm. And so if you can divide people into groups based on brain circuits that are relevant for intelligence, and then do molecular genetic studies in those groups, that might be tying the genes to the brain structure or function that's related to intelligence.
Yep. And the problem with neuroimaging studies, we can never get large enough samples. I mean, you talk about 200 is large. Well, in the genetics world, hundreds of thousands is what we're talking about. But when you find these genes in polygenic scores, you can have relatively small samples and be able to use these polygenic predictors. And these chips that you need to have to genotype them are getting very cheap. You know, maybe $40 you can do it now, which is nothing compared to the expense, you know, with fMRI, for example. So it really is happening, but it's going to be a tough one to take on board, because most neuroscientists, I'm sure not you guys, are still modular in their approach. You know, they're thinking about this bit of the brain for that, et cetera. But if there are so many genes involved, and I don't think this is just because it's phenotypic IQ, I think this is going to be the same story at the level of the brain, that there are many, many genes involved. I don't believe in endophenotypes for that reason, because it's thought that they're closer to the DNA, so they're going to be simpler. But anyone who thinks the brain is simple is simple. So I think there are going to be many, many genes involved, and that's not going to work for a modular approach. I think it's going to require a network connectionist system sort of approach to the brain. So it'll be fun, it'll be interesting to see neuroscience and genetics come together.
Robert, you spent a whole lot of time inside the DNA.
Sounds like Joe's voice, is it? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
Joe. You spent a lot of time inside the DNA, looking around, doing your best to identify the various polymorphisms and so on. I'm going to ask a question at a little bit different level. I've spoken to you many, many times, and we've had lunch. I don't think I've ever asked you what's your model for intelligence is. I think we all in this room agree that there's a G. What else? Do you like Carroll? Do you like Guilford? Do you like Cattell? What's
Well, I'm sure most of you know more about this than I do, but I tend to believe in a hierarchical model, you know, and the genetics seems to provide that structure as well. But you heard these talks on spatial ability, and what I've been trying to do, because G is so good, you know, it works, and I think Jensen was right with the indifference of the indicator. You know, it doesn't matter what test you use, you still get a decent G out of it. The Wendy Johnson work showed that you get G various ways, and they correlate at a latent level, you know, 0.9 or whatever. So G works really well, but there is more to cognition than G. I know a lot of people would say, of course. But what we've been trying to do is take spatial ability, where there hasn't been much work done. The work that's been done there has been very messy, what people call visualization and rotation. So we've been really trying to roll up our sleeves and take a good look at it and try very hard to try and find G-independent aspects of specific abilities, beginning with spatial. And you heard from Kylie Rimfeld's talk this morning, it didn't go so well. I mean, it's mostly like a general spatial factor, and a lot of that is G as well. But there's some there. And as this, we're doing these navigation studies, you saw that little clip of a virtual reality thing measuring navigation against a map, you know, that sort of thing. I have hopes that that will be less G-dependent as some of the others. And so it is kind of the hierarchical model, Joe, that I'm after. But I think G rules. I would never bet against G.
Other questions?
Well, thank you, Robert. This has been absolutely great.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.